We are live. So season one, conversation number 18. So roughly we have two more conversations in this season. And we have Sai Priya as a guest today. These conversations are brought to you by the Vivekananda Institute for Leadership Development, which is a unit of the Swami Vivekananda Youth Movement. And this particular session is also sponsored by the Vivekananda Institute for Indian Studies, which focuses on culture, bringing India and Indianness to the world. And that is why Dr. Rekha has also joined us. And in this particular season, we focused on conversations that bring speakers and people from a wide range of backgrounds and spanning topics of development, social issues, leadership and education, culture, heritage, education, and much more. And today we will be speaking with Priya on Indian polity, which she's been writing on about a lot. Culture, history, and caste. This, we've not structured it too much, so it's going to be a fairly unstructured kind of conversation where we perhaps go back and forth on a few issues. Before I actually start the conversation, I'll quickly introduce her. She's given me a very short introduction of herself. Priya is a doctor and currently a student of law. She's a passionate researcher and frequently writes about Indian history, polity, and culture. She tweets quite a lot and tweets at Priya_27. So, it's a pleasure to have you on the conversation.
Thank you so much for having me.
Okay, so I'll begin with the recent article that you wrote and I read specifically about the amendments being made to the legal minimum age of marriage for women in India. Not just unpacked the whole thing, but also made quite a few points that seem to suggest that the law seemed to be at cross purposes in terms of what it was hoping to deliver. It was not really delivering freedom or choice or any of those things that are dear to women, but rather, you know, taking all of that away. So could you unpack it a little, and then perhaps we could go a little back.
Sure. So my main contention is that the entire law, first of all, it's not based on like proper empirical evidence, because we didn't see any reports from the from any of the ministries responsible so far, at least. And the reasons that they gave were very superficial and kind of, like I put it in my article, I call it posturing, because they're just looking to probably appear like they're pro-women without thinking about what it actually means for the people it's going to affect. Because probably, as we know, like the upper middle class and the elite are a small minority of this country. And the law will affect basically all the women that currently marry below the age of 21. And there's no harm or shame in admitting that most of our country does, like around 67% or 70%. Even though the average age is around 22, there's still a far greater number that are actually marrying below 21. And 18 is already the age of adulthood according to the law. So you're giving women the right to, you know, vote, drink, you know, consent to sexual relations, enter into legal contracts and all of this, but you don't give them the freedom to marry, which is essentially another contract. Or we can't look at it that way, but you know what I mean. So it looks like it takes away freedom, and the state, if it wants to be paternal, instead of making decisions for people and their families, they should effectuate real change that actually helps them. The state made a point that it was about making sure that more women enter the education system and get a higher education and then enter the workforce, right? Where are the jobs? First, create some manufacturing jobs. The men, even the men are unemployed currently, and you're asking women to enter the workforce from where? So it's just completely, like, it's just a completely ludicrous rhetoric in my book. And yeah, so I had to write about it, just get it out there.
And specifically on the jobs, I think the bottom has fallen off, right? During COVID, particularly the women have simply disappeared from the workforce.
Yeah, so around 16% according to the ILO, but of course, you know, women are still employed in the
informal sectors, yes.
Sectors, you know, and of course, like, if you take the agricultural sector, you know that smaller farmlands are owned by a vast majority of farmers, and the women contribute to the work on land. So, and in villages and rural areas, if you just go, the women, the work they do is mainly contractual agricultural labor. So women are there in the workforce since, like, they work, but it's just not in the formal sector. And the problem here is there are no jobs in the formal sector. And if you see the stats, like I mentioned in the article, about 49% of people entering higher education are women, but they just don't enter the workforce because there's no jobs, and the quality of education is so bad that especially in the government aided colleges and all, they write some exam, they're not good at English, it's not taught properly, nothing is taught to them. Like, even in bigger universities, the teaching is bad. Like, I can openly admit it. Even the university I went, the teaching is bad. So government aided and government run institutions, the quality of education is so bad. Where are you equipping these people to even get a, to even compete for a job? Like, what are you talking about, right? And then you want to curb their personal choices on top of this. So I feel like, you know, the whole thing is just ludicrous. Just I don't understand what's going on even.
Right. The two things that you touched upon, one, you actually touched a raw nerve. I don't know if you will. One is about the fact that they can't speak English. So
yeah, you know
what happens when people say that. While we admit that, you know, just give me a minute. While we admit that, you know, English is the only language. The reason both of us are even communicating today is because English is the connecting language between us. And even but there seems to be this need to virtue signal, in a sense, to say that, you know, you don't need to know English and English is not important. You can manage in your local language. Nobody's saying don't learn your local language or don't study the local language or your mother tongue for that matter, or the language of your state. But increasingly, I mean, I just wanted to, you know, press this point that English is becoming the lingua franca across India in terms of the language that seems to connect a very, very diverse and multilingual kind of a country. So
I agree with you, but then again, it's hard because the thing is, while it may be easy for us to learn English because, see, again, English is taught badly in India. That's a fact. There are no good English teachers. There's very few of them. So the thing is, we learn because, you know, our parents know, or we just pick it up easier because, you know, at home we speak or someone can help us. And there's various media that we consume that helps us, right? So English is easy for us to pick up relatively. But for the vast majority of this country that really can't communicate in languages other than their mother tongue, and it's not taught to them properly. Plus, there's a huge disconnect between the culture and the language, and they like we see in other countries across Asia, technical subjects being taught in local languages make a huge difference to the way people engage with the content, with the science, with the terminology, and it makes them even. And even though they can't communicate or be like high level, you know, managerial positions and stuff, they can still do technical work. So, and that's been proven across Asia. So we need to adopt a sort of system that maybe probably incorporates more colleges that teach technical subjects in non-English, because it helps a large majority of population to better engage with the content and better engage and better understand technical subjects. So that's a huge, huge topic in itself, the reasons and the stats around that. But yeah, I sort of agree and disagree with you. But yeah, so, and like I said, English holds people back. That's just the fact. Whether not knowing it or knowing it, both are holding a majority of our population back. I'm not talking about people like us that are comfortable or like whatever. Talking about people that the government right now is trying to get to think about getting degrees rather than getting married, as if they're mutually exclusive, which they aren't. So, you know, that's another thing.
Yeah, no, my point is only limited to the fact that while learning the local language, for example, you know, my mother tongue is Tamil, I'm comfortable in that. I've been born and brought up in Bangalore, so Kannada is the language that I must speak and read and write as well. So I perfectly see that argument, but I'm saying that the more languages people learn, the better.
No, of course, yeah, that I agree.
So, but I'm going to play the devil's advocate to both, yeah, sure. You know, in terms of the specific article, because it's only a few days old since you wrote it. This is to do with, you know, the two arguments that the government, as well as, you know, quite a few people who seem to support this bill, is that one is they're talking about gender parity. You know, one is that men marry at the age of 21. So why is it 18 for women? Point one. Point two is, and I'm asking these questions, you know, and I'm playing the devil's advocate. Not
yeah, sure. No, go ahead. I welcome.
Yeah. The second issue that has come up is this is something that the women themselves wanted, is what the government, you know, in one of their arguments has made. It's something that they wanted. And the third is that there is a political imperative as well. Doing this has been on this one. So these are the three arguments. So what are your responses to that?
Sure, yeah. So the first thing about gender parity, I absolutely believe that there is a state mandated, like I mentioned in the article, the state mandates an age gap of 3 years between the man and the woman. So I feel like the age should be lowered for men as well to make it equal. And that's what the Law Commission actually recommended in 2008, but it wasn't acted upon. And you know, it wouldn't matter much because the average age of men, marriage for men is around 25 or something like that. Mm-hmm. So it wouldn't make such a huge difference. And then for men, you're also not concerned about pregnancy and nutrition and all of these other factors and you know, employment and all of this. So it wouldn't really make a difference, except like a few errant men eloping or something like that. So it's not, so if you want to fix parity, and that's the main issue, lower it like the Law Commission recommended. And actually, if you pull that up, they gave a few reasons, which, you know, you can look up if anyone wants to. But yeah, that's the first thing. The second thing you mentioned was, the government kept saying that the stakeholders wanted this, and it's kind of like a, you know, oh, we were doing the will of the public and all of that. But if you see the number of women they consulted and all, it's very minimal. And the other thing is, these are all, you know, these are not open-ended questions that they're asking women. You have to look at the survey and the contents to really break it down, because sometimes you can go into a survey and ask a woman, or do you think marriageable age should be, legal marriageable age should be 21, so that they can get educated and then get a job and then get a chance to be free like men? Like that's a loaded question, right? Right. It's not an open-ended question that you're asking people.
In a sense, to fix the outcome. Yeah.
Yeah, and also it depends on who you're asking. Are you asking lower middle class and up, or are you asking the rest of them? And even if you're asking girls that are younger or older or whatever, whoever you're asking, it depends on the way the questions are framed, and it depends on the percentage that you're asking in order to make these decisions. And we can make the argument that may be democratic, but at the end of the day, every democratic decision needn't be the best. And we know that from various decisions made over the years. So just because a decision is democratic doesn't mean it's even lawful, not lawful, but, you know, required. It's not necessary. Like, why? My main contention is it's just not necessary. Go and implement education policy. Go and implement healthcare policy. Bring rural healthcare to bring up lower maternal mortality, right? Bring education about birth control. Make access to abortion clinics. And then we'll talk about mandating an age for marriage, like it's, or increasing it. So there's a lot of, it's complicated. I feel like they want to appear progressive. I like the third point you made was political. And I feel like the political incentives in this are clear. Like, I'm sure, like, I don't know, this may be me speculating, but maybe they're trying to, you know, dip their foot in the pool a little bit, see how the the various communities react to a amendment to their personal laws. So if you're going to plan to amend their personal laws in the future, you probably want to make sure make a minor change and see if they're amenable to change or not. See how the various communities react, and then maybe dip into UCC a little bit, because that's been their goal. So who knows what their, who knows not? I'm speculating about their political incentive.
My understanding was that this law doesn't apply across communities, does it?
No, it does. I read the bill. It does.
Right. So it does
Parsi, apply. Christian, Muslim, all of them.
So obviously, so this is perhaps the first step towards the Uniform Civil Code.
And the craziest thing in the bill was they're going to amend the Prohibition of Child Marriage Act, and they're going to define a child as anyone under 21. So they're calling 18 to 21 year olds children.
Children, right.
It's just ludicrous.
So if that is the case, if it's going to be applied across the board to all communities, so that is one, you could say one change that has not been done earlier. You know, it used to, most of these kind of laws used to apply to only one community, which is the Hindu community, and not necessarily to the other communities.
Yeah.
They were covered under their own, they had the right. So which could be, but the UCC itself is a big, this one, I'm not very particularly
keen on it.
Yeah, very keen on it. Either.
Yeah, so yeah. So the amendment, the thing here is we need to understand, like, let's not blame other communities, because even Hindus have child marriage and it's fine. Right. Because it's fine as in I'm not going to make value judgments on other people's culture or traditions or customs. It's not my place. As long as they don't have much option and much else going on in terms of what the state is providing for them, I don't blame anyone for having these customs and traditions in place. I'm not going to sit on a high horse and judge these people for marrying their girls or whatever, because that's their financial status. That's their current status. You can't force a change, right? That's one. So we can be open about the fact that child marriages take place in Hindu community and Muslim community, and we can't blame just them for the whole thing. And maybe amendment of the personal law across the board might be it might look like it's trying to control child marriage, but it isn't, because child marriage is already prohibited. It's already criminalized.
Right.
So you're not affecting child marriage in the sense that someone below 18, right, or 16 year olds or whatever, which where it may be not in their best interest objectively, right? So this is the problem. Like, the argument that child marriage is egregious doesn't apply to this law, because we're talking about 18 to 21 year olds in the first place. We're not talking about POXO. We're not talking about any of these other things, right? So yeah, that's one big thing.
So before I actually move into the topic that you've, I think that you've written very incisively on, which is about the caste and all of that. I had one question. So
yeah, sure.
Yeah. You also edited, JSD's.
Yeah.
Okay, I keep saying JSD, so I should say JSD is JSI Deepak.
Yeah, it's fine. India,
That is Bharat. So, I think it's for the others in the audience also. So.
Right.
Yeah, and so I just wanted to know. So, how did that come about, and how was the experience of editing? Understanding is perhaps the book of not just 2021, but the book of the decade in terms of what it has done and
aims to do.
Mm.
Right.
The other two parts, right? Yeah.
So I don't know. It was completely accidental how it came about. Like, we just randomly talking. I was acquainted with him even before the book and all of this. So we just randomly talking. And he was telling me, I finished my book and all of that. And I was like, okay, what's it about? Just random questions. And it ended there that day. Like, he just told me what it's about and stuff. That happened. And then next week or something like that, he was sending a blurb to the publishers for the back cover or something. And he wanted to run it by someone. So he just sent it to me. And I kind of sat with him and edited that. And then I felt like he was like, okay, I might be good at editing the rest of it too. So he's like, we have only a month, but can you edit it? So I said, yeah, sure. Like, I don't mind. And I just sat with him and edited each chapter maybe like 2-3 times. So an intensive editing process in terms of the time crunch because he had like a month to release it. And then, yeah, he ended up releasing it on time and stuff, and he got like a massive response. So I'm glad that's happening, and you know, I'm glad people are picking up that book. And I feel like it's a good primer for someone who wants to understand why the country's state is the way it is, and why things are framed in the way they are when it comes to talking about Indians. So, yeah, I feel like it's an important book in that sense. Yeah,
and I think one of the big advantages is that it brings rationality to the arguments, because generally, you know, most of us, oscillate between rhetoric and rage. The typical, you know, response that we seem to come up with is lacks rationality in how we approach, making our arguments as well. So in that sense, I think that's the most important contribution that the book has made. So, okay, let's examine the caste question. It's a very convenient stick to beat us with, and most of us are extremely defensive about it as well. It's nobody's argument that there haven't been any excesses at all. I mean, that's never the argument. But it's most of us, have been fed the colonial narrative on this, that caste is an institutional framework of being, even being Hindu. And this attempt to equate Hindu dharma with caste and little else, that's the first thing that I wanted to go back and forth with you in terms of how do you see this? And my own understanding is that, excesses of any have happened both ways. It's not just one community, if at all, one community or other. I think it's always been a two-way street. And it's always been more about social capital, cultural capital, all of those things. So if you could.
Yeah, that's true. So thing with equating the entirety of dharma and Hinduism with only caste, it doesn't have merit in terms of academia, in the sense that if you see leftist academia and academia abroad, and the way they look at caste, obviously it doesn't have any bearing and or any legitimacy. But if you see everyday practice and the customs that people inherit, caste is a major part of what are not only the rituals that we partake in, the way we do things, all like a lot is governed by caste. That's just a fact. And I think we're all better off acknowledging it sooner than later. Only because it's pointless to, kind of run away from this and be like, oh, we're casteless, we're above this, we're spiritual. No, it doesn't work, because if you have a certain identity and if you have a certain lineage, and everyone respects their ancestors and their forefathers, and that's one of the big equations in dharma, even, because like ancestor worship across castes is a big part of it. So the entire jati traditions and the everything is linked to caste. So I don't completely discount the argument, but also the way it's made to us to denigrate us, that's not obviously not legitimate. So that's my take on that. And I'll get into it more as I answer your next question. Yeah.
I think one of the questions that, it's important is that how did jati, which seems to be the only reality of India, get converted into this oppressive word caste? And caste has, literally being equated with slavery, for example.
Right.
We didn't, pack healthy men out of some other country, lock them up into little ships and ship them across the world. But this whole, which has no reference anywhere in our culture. There's no reference to caste anywhere in the culture. Varna and jati are, to some extent, culturally relatable, though not. And then how did the state now, come up with so many castes and subcastes? It seems to,
it stemmed from, it's an entirely colonial project. So it started in the 18th century to 19th century, when British anthropologists and civil servants would study India and write about India, especially after 1857. So what happened after 1857 is the British wanted to understand Indian society better in order to govern them better and in order to prevent such an uprising from ever occurring again. So this, it basically started after the 1857 revolt. And after this, you see a huge number of anthropologists and other, you know, people from the civil services and otherwise being commissioned to write about Indian society, right? So write about folklore, about castes, about everything, religion, the customs, right? Their superstitions, their behavior, right? So everything was being trying to be recorded so that it helps them understand society better and use it to our detriment, obviously. So that's the agenda. And then we come to how the study of jati started, right? The major compendiums that exist from colonial literature are basically those of, you know, Risley and his protege Thurston. Thurston did a huge, the South Indian Castes and Tribes, the volume, 7 volumes. And then someone called William Crook did a huge, I'm not sure if it's Crook or Crooks, but he did a huge compilation of castes and tribes.
Name sounds okay for this.
And then even William Hunter. So all these people, like they stay around the same time as well. So all these people did a compilation, right? And let's take Risley. Let's take Risley for example. His work was basically based around ethnography and racial study. So he did a survey, if you can call it that. He would basically go across, you know, remote interior villages and towns of India, and he, Risley and Thurston both, actually, Thurston majorly. So they would go into these interior parts, ask these different tribes and jatis and castes, which caste they belong to, right? And nobody knows. So this is crazy. If you ask people what caste they belong to, they don't know. They only know their jati. They don't know their varna. And therefore, there was sort of a gap between the accuracy in the reporting that he was doing. First of all, there's a huge communication gap. So he even reports himself that, you know, many of them can't understand what I'm saying or what I'm asking. And so there's a communication gap. There's so many other issues that are, you know, basically confounding the entire study. And he would ask these people orally, right, and just write down whatever they said, whether right or wrong. He doesn't know whether it's right or wrong. They themselves are not sure what varna they belong to, right? And depending on their either economic status or something, he started classifying them into lower castes and higher castes, right? Which is another issue I'll get to soon. Low and high, I'll get to this. So he started just classifying them based on esoteric factors and putting them into all these groups as far as what he could observe. And he also did these, like I mentioned, ethnographic measurements, right? He would take these bigger versions of vernier calipers and place them inside people's mouths and measure their jaws and their hair, skull and their heights and their noses, their nose size and all of this. Because he was convinced that the higher castes were a different race than the lower castes, right? Because he was inspired by like French anthropologists and racial studies, what's his name? Forget his name. But he took methods from there and he started measuring, right? And then he started recording all of this. And basically a racist, like complete racist. He's trying to find distinctions in race between the castes of India or between the people of India. He's trying to distinguish them. His agenda is to distinguish them from each other and not to understand them. His other agenda is to govern them in order to control them rather than understand them from a genuine perspective.
And perhaps also to ensure that, you know, to sell the narrative that we were never one people. So
right. So yeah. So I'm getting to that. It's a story. So these people, yeah, so he did all of this. And the crazy thing is, after all these were published and all that in the following decades, I found a paper recently which is just blew my mind. Their contemporaries in Britain actually denounced their work and said this work is completely inaccurate. Especially Risley's work was completely criticized by contemporary, not us, white British scholars in Britain criticized Risley's work for being inaccurate because of the way the surveys were conducted and the assumptions that he made during the course of his work and all of this, right? So denounced by his own contemporaries when the parliament, when the UK parliament was about to make certain laws based on Risley's study. So you can see the inaccuracies, the meddled with inaccuracies, and they're making laws on this. And they have opposition in the parliament saying that they're inaccurate, but they're not stopping. They're trying to make policy. And you see exactly what happened after when the Indian state inherited these policies. And we base our policy on British studies of caste. So how do we expect to connect with it? How do we expect it to be genuine? How do we expect people to be represented? So honestly, if you want every caste to self-actualize, you can't base it on British studies of caste, right? How because they don't know what they're talking about. The studies are first of all outdated, even if they were accurate. So it's a complete gap between the policy that India employs towards caste and the caste themselves. Like there's no connection. There's no understanding of culture. There's no understanding of the economics of caste. There's no genuine understanding of anything from the side of the Indian state. And they refuse to conduct a survey now or a census now, which might be controversial. So we're stuck with British thoughts on this matter. And then coming to the hierarchy thing that I mentioned, it just got worse and worse. It snowballed because if you see, I think Louis Dumont, he wrote Homo Hierarchicus. He basically compiled all this information and wrote about castes in the sense that he put them in a pyramid, right? That was the first we saw a proper, you know, solidification of the pyramid and all of that. And Homo Hierarchicus became the seminal text on caste throughout the world in the, you know, 1960s, 70s and all. So and you see Western scholars base their entire work and their study so far, whatever they've done, on these different anthropological studies, which are completely divorced from the realities of castes in India. So and then we see Marxist historians and leftists in India just copy pasting what Western scholars are saying. They don't approach subaltern studies or caste studies from the lower level. They approach it from top down, as if the colonizers would, which maybe they think they're helping, but they're not, because no jati has benefited from any of these things that they've written about them. So you know, it's a complete mess. I think work with Hallie and stuff and write about Homo Hierarchicus. That's in the works. And then let's see. Yeah, it's frustrating.
Yeah, I agree that it's a complete mess. But perhaps it's also got to do with the state that inherited this, you know, the Indian state that inherited it from the from their colonizers. Perhaps they found it and still find it extremely useful to continue this this one. I mean, you still have people referring to Risley and all of that in terms of, I mean, you talked about Marxist historians and leftists, but that's and it perhaps helps the state as well to continue to govern people and, you know, keep them in these little little groups, that it's easier to govern, easier to control. So that's perhaps one of the reasons why there is a refusal to re-examine many of the things.
And even and when we talk about, I think there was a question that's come up in the chat privately, which is about Varna and Jati. In my opinion, you know, Varna is, and I may be completely wrong, but I've seen it more like a kind of a normative ideal for a functional society to align itself along, you know, for an individual, for example, to locate his vocation and all of that, and also for the society, some kind of a normative ideal. And within that, there are jatis. And for example, even, we think Brahmins are one, but there are so many jatis within Brahmins themselves, right? You take Vaishyas, there'll be so many jatis within that. So that's it. But you're the expert. So I'll let you
answer. I'm not an expert by any means. This is just
You've done a fair amount of work. I haven't done much.
So yeah, this is just my casual reading. If anyone listening to this is free to correct me, please tweet it or send me an email or a message. If I'm wrong anywhere, I'm happy to learn. I'm not an expert by any means. This is just me casually reading this stuff, not even seriously.
Expert, relatively speaking.
So first to just talk about what you mentioned. I guess in the way that the British saw separate identities being more governable, the Indian state basically exploits this and weaponizes caste for, you know, political incentives. Right. So that's there. That's absolutely. And again, I feel like the caste themselves, the lower castes especially, are they fearful of their dwindling traditions? Because I am. I want every caste to protect their heritage, right? If you see, say the weaver caste, I'll just give you an example. There's a local weaver caste here called Padmashalis. And they have their own, most jatis have their own jati purana or kula purana or whatever. And for the Padmashalis, it's the Markandeya Purana, and they have a story and they have a birth story, and that's the origin of their caste, right? And you see other tribals also, they have various stories like, oh, we're born from Narasimha, and like there's so many different castes have their own jati puranas, right? So if you see the Padmashalis, they have certain bards who actually sing this and perform the Markandeya Purana for initially for like other castes, as in a certain caste was their patron who would employ them every year. And they're all interlinked. So they're interlinked to other jatis. Their traditions are interlinked. And you see these bards. There's I think one or two of them left in the world. So there's no attempt to restore and protect these sort of jati specific traditions. And instead, they want to make quote unquote create a casteless society and want to make everyone uniform. So they're basically, while claiming to be for diversity, they're against diversity, and they're actually against protecting these traditions that make people unique and diverse, right? So that's one of the big, factors. And can you just mention your question again? I'm sorry, I went on a tangent.
The second part of it, I said, or rather the first part of it, you answered the second part. The first part of it was about my own take that, you know, Varna is more a normative ideal.
Right.
As opposed to for a functional society to align itself along both both the level of the individual and the collective.
Right.
And you know, you can belong to a Varna, but you'll have multiple jatis within the Varna.
Right. Like, yeah.
For example, I could say the Vaishnava Sampradaya is a separate jati within the, because
not exactly a jati, it's a sampradaya.
Right. Yeah, but I'm saying you could have multiple jatis in a Varna kind of thing.
Yeah, that's there, yes. The thing with this is, it's, you could say it's kind of an umbrella classification. Because if we see in the history of many different kingdoms and all, if there was a time of strife, lower castes, higher castes, everyone would become Kshatriya or there were different kingdoms governed by different castes at different points of time, not just Brahmin kingdoms who assumed the role of kings and therefore became Kshatriya. Like we see these examples, I mean, they're not really serious, but the larger point is true, as in it's like an overarching, Varna is like an overarching thing, whereas Jati is more solid and more linked to the specific identity of an individual. And it could be linked with, it is linked with culture and economy. and interdependence, not just among the jati. Like, if you see like prehistory, but like in the beginnings of tin extraction and metallurgy and all of these things, these are caste-based and caste-specific, right. Caste-owned knowledge. So they would not teach it to any other caste. They basically monopolized extraction of metal, and they would only teach it to their son-in-law or son.
Right.
And they control the market, right? In that case, so it's caste has a benefit in that sense that now obviously maybe not in the modern world because they're not practicing their hereditary occupations, but back then caste played a very important economic role which people just want to ignore. So and when they want to talk, and you know, if we start talking about religion, like there's a lot of culture linked with jati. Everyone has their own temples, they have their own deities, they have their own kula deities, right? Yeah. So
the devatas.
Yeah, so everyone, every caste has their own thing, and this is a big reason why there was never a uprising. Like people keep asking this question, why wasn't there an uprising if castes were so oppressed, right?
Right.
Because you see in history, in any part of the world, wherever there's oppression for a long duration, for a consistent period of time, there it ends in an uprising. It absolutely ends in an uprising of the peasant class. Like if you see feudalism under the Nizams, like there was a peasant uprising, right? So whenever there's continued oppression, there is an uprising. But why didn't we see in history an uprising against the Brahmins, right? Because the Brahmins did their own thing and these people did their own thing. These people didn't subscribe to the Brahminical religion until the colonial people came and said, Brahminical deities, you worship Brahminical deities, but you also don't. And they sort of normalized Brahminical Hinduism as being the only type and being the dominant type, which it really wasn't, because if you see in numbers, it really wasn't. Probably because their interactions were with Brahmins, they sort of legitimized Brahminical Hinduism, which they are calling it that.
And the colonial masters also had to, get over the, because I think their biggest obstacle to taking over the conversion was the Brahmin community.
Yeah, so unless it came through Brahmins, nobody would listen to anyone. They only had, some respect for Brahmins left. So obviously they wanted to appropriate and use Brahmins to their advantage, in the sense that get them on your team and then you can use them.
There are a couple of questions that's come up specifically.
Yeah, sure.
You said just now, I don't know, did you see one of them, or what is the caste system?
I only have,
okay, so no.
What is the caste system based on?
Yeah, I think that's the only one that's come in the...
It's too vague, I don't know.
In the open chat, I think one of the questions that's come up is, if the just because there was no uprising, do you justify that there is no oppression of caste?
No, that's not what I'm saying at all. Just to clarify, of course there was oppression meted out to certain castes, and I guess we've crossed that bridge in a way, and now it's time to think about how to help every caste and, self-actualize, protect their traditions and their languages and their customs, because they're so unique and they're important, and protect their hereditary occupations. Because if you see, sthapatis and artisans, there's so much art to preserve. There's so much heritage. So I think we've crossed the bridge. There might be casual casteism, which I'm not going to say it doesn't exist, because just like casual racism exists in the West, of course it does exist. That's not what I'm saying. Of course there is. I'm not trying to justify any of the quote unquote evils. I'm just trying to make a different point, give you a different point of view. This stuff is already out in the open already. Yeah. People are saying these things.
I think absolutely. I think there's just one narrative, so there's no point in us, talking about that again.
Yeah, yeah. So
that's the narrative all of us have been taught at school, and we've seen only one side of the coin.
And as for what is a caste system based on, I think the Purusha Sukta and the Rig Veda and stuff, that's where it stems from. But also you can you can also look at it like sort of Manusmriti sort of codified it, if you could say that, or presented the ideal situation. And the when British scholars came, they sort of elevated these texts as the seminal texts. So so whether the origin was actually from there or not, it's attributed to these two texts.
And I think it's also important for people to realize that this utopia that they talk of a casteless society is an impossibility. Some level of social stratification is absolutely essential for a functional society. I mean, to talk of a casteless society is to live in, you know, la la la. I don't think that's ever happening, kind of.
Yeah.
I mean, you can substitute caste with class if you want to, but some level of social and cultural stratification is going to be there. Have you read Professor Arvey's Caste and Social Capital?
No, I don't think so. But I've read another parts of another book which is kind of similar, and it's related to, I think, the Chettiars in Tamil Nadu, and their it's a case study about that. They're a banking caste, actually, and so it's a case study in observing and, you know, making and talking about economics centered around caste. Is that I've read something similar. I haven't read Arvey's book. He's going to be angry if I say I haven't, but yeah, I haven't.
Yeah, but I think Professor Arvey also talks very similar things, you know.
Yeah.
And his whole book, you know, looks at caste through the lens of business, economics, and
right.
I think entrepreneurship. And he talks a lot about the Chettiars. In his book as well.
So just to answer a couple of questions from the chat, right. I guess, what propelled me to law? So I guess I always had a foot out of medicine for a while, and for the past like year or so, like I kind of delved so deep into this world, I felt like I couldn't go back and do justice to medicine, and also like kind of JSD kind of nudged me and like you'd be good at this, like I'm serious, like I think you should take it up. And that sort of gave me some confidence to actually take that step. It's kind of risky and kind of unorthodox. And also my parents don't really agree with me. So yeah, it's kind of a difficult decision. But I thought, you know, I could do this more justice, even though I'll probably make less money and stuff.
And you know, I'm more or less veering around to the idea, you know, there are people who talk about the various ways in which, but I'm veering around to JSD's idea of that whatever solutions we need to find needs to be found within the boundaries of the constitutional law that we have. I think that's the way to go in terms of, I think that's broadly what his thrust has been in the recent this one. So I think I'm also veering around. I was not subscribing to that, but I'm seeing the rationale merit. Rather the merit and all of that and what that's been made. Though I'm still on the wall in terms of,
Maybe I'll get back to you after I read some constitutional law.
A couple more, I think. Please mention the books to read to know the difference between Varna, Jati, Kulam. I think that's
it's very difficult to recommend books because books, this absolutely. Stuff is sourced from all sorts of places. There's right. no proper, from our perspective, there's no proper arguments being compiled into a book. So I feel like you'd have to read a lot and sort of draw your own conclusions and really analyze what the intention of that certain text is. And it's kind of difficult. I feel like, you know, I want to like keep writing a series of articles. So if you can just follow and make sure you just catch articles when I compile them, because it's impossible for even me to like read so many books. But if I do it and compile it, it's much easier to get like a snapshot of what is happening. Because there's no book that gives you everything you need. Like there are books that talk about, say, artisan classes from their perspective or like someone else. And there are some very good books to that effect, but you won't find it as like a sort of compilation where everything you need to know. Caste for Dummies, there's no book.
No, those are books that are famous.
That's the joke.
Yeah. Yeah, is there another question? I don't see anything.
Caste system, organization of work. Yeah, I guess so. There are multiple ways to look at it. It was an organization of work plus an organization of, religion and customs. It's an organization of various things. And I guess the Indian population is always high, and there's a way to, maybe it's just a cultural thing, in the sense that maybe from the beginning, Indians have always been sort of tribalist in that sense, in the sense that.
I don't think it's something that's unique to our country.
Look at
the Japanese. You know, they had a very clear stratification. So also did the earlier civilizations. All of them seem to have some sort of stratification.
How do you justify self-appraising of each caste with interrelations between castes? And there's no truth, as we all have our own biases. I don't really understand. Can you explain that question, please?
Well, I did not touch it because I didn't understand it either.
So. Yeah, me neither. So whoever wrote that, please just give me an explanation and I'll answer. And is a Varna of an individual only defined based on their primary occupation? No, again, like Varna, your Jati sort of determines your Varna, and your Jati is quite unique to your birth. So it's kind of, I don't want to talk about fluidity because there are multiple arguments floating around fluid, rigid, and all of this. It's just not, I guess it's not useful to us. Whenever there's a change in the source of income, no, I don't think so at all. Like, I feel like you're looking at it very myopically, and it's kind of, I don't know, maybe I'm looking at it.
No, wrong, I think the fluidity argument.
It's just not, it doesn't help anyone. Let's not, at least in the modern age, it's been pretty rigid. So let's just go from there, because if we start talking about fluidity, it goes into the medieval ages and the following centuries. So if we just take the modern age, it's been pretty rigid, and it's not really based on source of income, because again, that went up and down because of various invasions. So kind of difficult to make that.
Even this fluidity argument is not actually based on facts. If you look at
it, doesn't help.
I think the single source from which they draw this thing is from the Bhagavad Gita, where that particular verse is interpreted as Bhagavan talking about
based on karma.
But the Kanchi Paramacharya clarifies, saying that even karma is connected to birth, and therefore what he is saying is what he is not saying is to be understood as having been said.
So exactly. Mm-hmm. So our dharma and our and the nature of our karma and the duties assigned to us essentially are based on birth. And there are various rituals prescribed to various householders, to various castes. So we can't really separate the two. They're kind of inextricable. Please mention. Okay, we answered that. Varna. Okay, we descend. Why do we not have a census? Because it's politically loaded. I guess you can catch our RV sir's talk on P Gurus. He talked about this a few months ago, I think, and that was really it was really good talk. I go and catch it. He talks about why it's too controversial to bring about a caste census, and I feel like that is very insightful.
Very insightful.
Go and catch that,
And for people who don't know, that's Professor R. Vaidyanathan.
R. Vaidyanathan, yes.
And P. Gurus is the YouTube channel that you would
like.
We are almost at the end of this. We seem to have touched on a lot of things, but there's so much that is still left unsaid in terms of, because we have about 50-55 minutes to speak. So much that did not.
So are there any questions left from on your list?
On my list, no, there are many questions, but I didn't.
We ran out of time.
No, I didn't run out of time. I didn't look at those questions, but I think when I'm just scrolling through them, I see that most of it's
got been covered. Right. Okay.
We did not actually go through the questions in the same order or in.
I'm sorry about that.
That's perfectly fine. Typically how these conversations play out, because there is an organic kind of shift that happens once we start speaking. So that's perfectly fine. I think the whole idea, I think the whole purpose, if this conversation could serve one purpose, is that if people start to question some of the things that they've been told, right, from
the dominant narratives, right? Yeah.
The dominant narrative, and then start to read and explore. I think these are not things that we can cover in about a 60-minute conversation. It's not something that you can listen to somebody and get to grasp or get to understand. I think it's very important for people to read source texts, and also read with the purpose of trying to understand. I think most of us, you know, are so comfortable not reading and accepting whatever is being fed to us. I think that shift needs to happen. Second is, I think, if I may say that as well, is that we must get out of this savior kind of mentality, that there's one person who'll save us, there's one person who'll do this. That needs
so
to
it
come
starts
out.
With us, and you're right. I think we need to start bringing about changes, especially parents of children. Like, I really want them to, you know, there are a lot of changes that parents can make to make sure, because we're assaulted with the education system from every angle. So I feel like parents have a big role to play in shaping the future of this country. And the other thing is, I want young people in academia, especially, you know, students of history and culture and law and politics and economics, to really think about pre-colonial texts and like read more, you know, because if you see any field right now is just completely based on modern stuff, like even the law is completely touted to be a Western invention. Even medicine, I talked about this once in a thread in an article as well. Medical ethics is considered a Western invention. And students in India are taking the Hippocratic Oath when we have our own oath from Charaka. And he has a huge writing on why it's important for a doctor to be moral. Mm-hmm. And the practices he must inculcate to be fair and just. And he talks about taking money and confidentiality. He literally talks about confidentiality back then. And so these are not Western concepts. So we need to break free from this and really think about where these ideas come from and source it from our own texts and own them and really be aware of these things and not believe everything we read. And I know reading is a very difficult habit, especially we're surrounded by so much media that's completely, you know, entertaining. So I know reading is a very difficult habit, even for me, it's very difficult because it's difficult to sit down and finish a book.
Nowadays it's very difficult.
Yeah.
Me as well. So.
And we have so much other stuff to do. It's difficult to make time. So yes, read more, but also choose carefully what you're reading. There's so much out there. And when you're reading, like, make sure you approach it critically. Think about what and who and why, because it's important to, you know that everyone has a certain bias. So like think more, be more aware is what I can say. And like I said, parents have it cut out for them.
Right. I'll now hand it over to Dr. Rekha for her closing remarks. Yeah. Oh, I need to unmute you. Sorry. Rana had muted everybody. So. Yeah, you can unmute yourself.
Yeah, thank you, Ramesh. I was able to. Yeah, okay. So thank you very much for this enriching conversation, Dr. Sai Priya, and of course carried over by Mr. Ramesh. And I think this has left us a lot of food for thought on all the topics discussed today, be it the legal age of marriage or English language, and of course major part of the discussion happening on the caste. Yeah, in fact, it was actually very surprising to know the passing of a bill on age of marriage without a proper empirical report. And I think it was a great insight that through your article or through the discussions that we had. And of course, we completely agree about the language component that you were speaking, completely neglected, or I must say, given less importance in our education system, in fact, which can fill in so much of gap in between and employment and also the skilled employees in all sectors. So that was a great insight. And we have been doing small attempts in the communities that we work, especially in Swami Vivekananda youth movement, in our schools and other things, to see that we also encourage students on all the language components also. Yeah, and of course, caste is a very, very vast topic to discuss.
And controversial.
Yeah, of course, definitely we agree. And it was very interesting to know the perspective of inherited culture on the economics. And also thank you for sharing about the colonial project for easy governance. If we all reflect, I think it somehow it is still carried even in the contemporary India, especially on during thinking of elections and other things. The governance is getting into more on all those things. So thank you so much for all these discussions. And last but not the least, thank you for reminding us that we should keep reading. And this is good to know. It's a difficult habit for everybody.
Yeah, it is.
So
yeah,
definitely each of us will know I'm not reading much as required. Yeah, that's something that we should all get into, especially with all these social medias and with the digital learning. It's really hard for everybody has lots that